I'd like to call the Zoning Board of Appeals meeting for Wednesday, August 18th, 6:30. Everyone rise for the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
If I can remind everybody, please make sure you speak directly into the microphone when you speak. Thank you.
I'd like to recognize Mr. Campbell.
Mr. Pearl, as Secretary of the ZBA, in the absence of the designated chairperson and vice chairperson, it's my duty to appoint a chairperson for the night, and I've appointed Mr. Pearl to be chairperson.
Thank you. Okay. Welcome, everyone. This is a hybrid meeting, our first ZBA meeting like this. So it just turns out that all the commissioners that are present in this Township Zoning Board of Appeals membership are here. The others are excused, but let's do roll call.
Could you speak a little louder?
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Alexander?
Present.
Mrs. Amor-Porter?
Present.
Mr. Campbell, here. Mr. Merrill?
Here.
Mr. Pearl?
Here.
Mr. Zook?
Here.
Also in attendance is the chairperson of director of the Department of Planning and Community Development to advise the board, Mr. Bruce Thompson.
And both Ron and Mike are excused.
All right.
For the record. Thank you. As a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, Clinton Township Supervisor has declared an emergency authorizing remote participation in public meetings in order to avoid person-to-person contact. Obviously, tonight we're doing it both ways. So there will be people speaking from the audience here, I assume, and there could be people on the internet. A dedicated email address has been established directing your emails if you're doing it through the internet. And the email address is zba@clintontownship-mi.gov. Throughout the meeting and on agenda items, your email relating to a specific agenda item will be read prior to the zoning board voting on each agenda item. Further, following consideration of all agenda items, persons who have connected remotely will be permitted to speak. Existing rules regarding public participation otherwise fully apply. A couple items that I have to go over. The functions relate to the authority of the zoning board. The Board of Appeals functions as a quasi-judicial body with specific powers and limitations as outlined in the various sections of the zoning ordinance and the state statutes. The zoning ordinance sets the standards the board must use in reaching any decision. Once a decision of the board becomes final, only the courts can modify or reverse that decision. The board is not empowered to change the terms or intent of an ordinance, therefore you must petition the Township Board of Trustees if you wish to amend an ordinance. Before a variance can be granted, certain requirements must be satisfied. The first is practical difficulty must be demonstrated. Number two, whether strict compliance with area setbacks, frontage, height, bulk, or density would be unreasonably prevent the owner from using the property for permitted use or would render conformity unnecessarily burdensome. Three, whether a variance would do substantial justice to the petitioner as well as other property owners in the district, or whether a lesser relaxation would give substantial relief and be more consistent with justice to others. Number four, whether the plight of the owner is due to unique circumstances of the property. With that, we'll go to the approval of the agenda. Need a motion to approve the agenda?
So move.
Support.
All those in favor? Well, roll call vote? Are you just going all those in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Were there any additions, by the way, to the agenda that we missed?
No.
Okay, thank you. The first item is SFR Katzman 22534, Lot 103. The address would be 22534 Katzman Drive. Permit construction of a 4-foot-high white vinyl privacy fence on property. This is coming back to us. When the petitioner, I just want everyone to know that's petitioning us tonight, that because we don't have the 7-member board present, you do have the option to delay this to another meeting where there's a full board present. So let us know when you come up. Would the first petitioner come up and step up at the podium?
Mr. Chairperson?
Yes, Mr. Yeah, I'm sorry.
I should also note that there was no new mailing sent to owners and occupants within 300 feet because this was a postponement from the June meeting.
That's right. Thank you, Mr. Campbell. State your name and address for the record, please.
My name is Lou Ratria Siplin. I live at 22534 Katzman, Clinton Township. I moved there in 2013 in October. And in 2014, my husband tried to cut the hedges. He thought it was our property, but it was not. It's property of 22510. And I told him I would cut him. He was a dialysis patient 3 days a week, heart surgery, high blood pressure, and 2 back operations. So I told him I will buy an electrical hedger and cut the hedges. I cut them in 2014, 2015, 2016, 2017, 2018, 2019, 2020, and 2021. Because my neighbor at 22510 does not understand. When you buy a house, you buy the property on the back, you buy the property in the front, and you buy the property on the side. He had hedges on the side. I had this gentleman over here to put me in a privacy fence because my neighbors in the back had a wire fence. And I put tomatoes out there. I didn't appreciate the rabbits eating up my tomatoes. So I had to go to the back 6 times to get an okay to put up a privacy fence. I paid for everything. She didn't have to pay for one penny because I do not appreciate it working putting tomatoes out there, and the rabbits come through the wire fence.
Can I interrupt
eating my
you
tomatoes?
Just a second? You've already explained this to us. Mr. Campbell, do you want to read the letter that in the record, June 30th letter?
The
explaining what we're looking for, just to refresh everybody? Or
the July 30th letter? The planner's analysis?
You don't have the online agenda.
If you don't have a copy of the letter, I have a copy of the letter.
Basically, we met on June 16th to hear this, and you explained all that to us at that time. But we asked you to go back and get...
I have pictures of the hedges that are dying.
Regarding the removal, that you have authority to remove the existing hedge where the fence
for free
is proposed.
Because that's the only way I'm going to get them removed.
Number one. And then the second one was you were changing the fence to a 4-foot-high vinyl picket fence instead
open,
of what you proposed.
Open white picket fence.
Right. I think that's the letter. If you don't have it, that's basically the letter. So that's what we asked you.
And this is what I brought in and showed.
And
they made copies of it. The gentleman signed off on it. His English is
very poor. Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
So I'll just confirm that is the case. The last time Mrs. Siplin was before us, it was postponed so that we could get confirmation that the neighbor was okay with Mrs. Siplin cutting down or her designee cutting down those hedges. And there was a concern that having a solid vinyl fence would be a vision obstruction. And she'd indicated that she would be willing to place a picket fence in place of the vinyl fence. Both those pieces of information were transmitted to the planning department, and I do appreciate that, Mrs. Siplin. I know that took some work, and certainly we're here to help you on that. And so that information, the reason it was postponed, that information is available. It is part of the packet. So we do have confirmation in writing from the neighbor that she has the okay to take that down. And again, it's a vinyl picket fence versus a vinyl solid fence, as discussed at that meeting. And so that's really at question this evening. Is the zoning board ready to move forward, given that information?
Right.
Thank you.
And it will be 36 inches from the sidewalk. That's what I was told. Right now, the hedges are a foot from the sidewalk.
So I hope you don't mind me interrupting you. I didn't want you to have to go through the whole story again.
I've been living with this for 8 years.
Okay. I wanted to make it easier on you. So those were the two things we asked. So if you have nothing new, we have the answers to those two. We'd like to go to the rest of the audience to see if they have any questions before we go to the board. Thank you for bringing all that in.
Okay.
So we'll be right back to you. Is there anyone in the audience that has a question? Could you just have a seat for a minute? Thank you.
In this case,
name and address for the record.
My name and address: Sam Bushell, 18546 Wayland Drive, Clinton Township, Michigan. In this case, this property is much more landlocked, which is the practical difficulty addressed in the J. Dolan Township Attorney's email of today sent by me to the ZBA this morning. Basically, the landlock covers just about every property in Harris and in Clinton Township now, because they're again at 26 South Grosbeck. The ZBA granted many variances, including a bar, restaurant, outside patio with zero setback from the adjacent residential property. The front side and backyards all had expanded uses, including a dumpster in the side yard next to the front yards of the residential homes. A vinyl fence, which we're talking about tonight, was substituted for the required masonry wall in that case to protect the adjacent residential district. The reduced parking the ZBA granted has had much of it on the right-of-way of Grosbeck that MDOT has demanded be removed. With this being a residential property, you are granting the expansion of the long-abandoned non-conforming use on each tonight's cases cannot be denied. If you choose to deny any of the cases tonight, they could sue the citizens of Clinton Township that you have a paid fiduciary position with. They would need to find out how the fix was in for 26 South Grosbeck. You must approve all of these landlocked properties for the requested variances. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else in the audience that would like to speak tonight to this issue? I'm not hearing anyone. Bruce, is there anybody on the internet that wants to speak to this issue?
There is not.
Are there any emails, Mr. Thompson?
No, sir.
Okay, I'll move to the board. Is there anybody, any members? Mr. Campbell?
Yes, thank you. I've looked at this a number of times, and one of the things that just came up this afternoon was we did a search on past fence cases. This was done with the support of the clerk's office, because up until a few months ago, fence variances were handled by the township board. It's only relatively new that the ZBA has responsibility to deal with fence variance requests. And what I saw was that there have been variances granted in the past for fences in the front yard. They've been granted, basically, it seems like a standing condition is that it's for picket fences, not privacy fences, which I believe is the was the outcome of your discussion and agreement with Mr. Thompson. The picket fences in one case were identified that the pickets had to be 12 inches, separated by 12 inches. If you're in agreement with that, I can support a motion to allow a picket fence with the individual pickets 12 inches apart.
You have a picket fence on Katzman already.
Well, the truth is, I know where it is. I've seen it. I've looked at it. there's no indication that that is legal. Because, you know, people do things sometimes, and they neglect the detail of getting official approval for it. It appears from what we see that that one was not granted approval by the township. Now, the other aspect of the whole thing that I found interesting is the, you talk about the hedges being dead and wanting to get rid of them. As of last week, all of a sudden those hedges look pretty good. And they're nice and thick, and I think it would be difficult for dogs and others to get through. But maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I didn't look close enough. But
these hedges are not thick. I got pictures of them. When they show them where dogs can go through the hedges, weeds grow up between the hedges. They're dying.
Okay.
I lived there 8 years, and I've been cutting them that long.
I understand. In that case, you know, I would wind up supporting a motion to grant you the variance on the condition that the pickets be 12 inches apart.
Okay. Mr. Thompson, what was the agreement between you and the petitioner?
Well, I don't think that there was any agreement, sir, through the chair. I'm sorry. It was just the discussion was not a solid fence, but being a picket fence. That's all that I recall that the discussion centered around, not, you know, distance between posts or distance between pickets. Sorry.
Okay.
Bruce, the 12 inches I got from the search that was done.
Yeah, I understand. But let's go to anyone else on the board. Have a question?
Yeah.
Mr. Zup? I was told 36 inches.
Well, wait 1 second. Let's finish up first, okay? Mr. Zup?
In the original petition, the petitioner wrote that the purpose of the fence was to keep the dogs from accessing her property and using it for a restroom. I'm still trying to figure out how this wall will prevent that from happening. The dogs can still walk to the end of the fence, walk on around it and onto her property. So it doesn't seem like it's going to solve any issues that were originally stated in the petition, was to have the dogs stop using her property as a toilet.
Okay. One second. Let's finish. Mr. Mayor?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do appreciate you taking the time and working at working with the building department or the planning department to address the issues that we were concerned about previously. You know, one of mine was safety of visibility coming around the corner right there by your house. I think that, you know, if you keep it 3 foot off the sidewalk, or, you know, I think that you'd be fine for to be able to have that up. I do agree with Mr. Zook that we were talking about, you know, keeping animals off of the property and defecating and using the bathroom there. You know, but at the same time, I understand where Mr. Campbell's coming at and using history to come back and look at the 12-inch, you know, spacing in the pickets. 12 inches is a lot. I think that doesn't solve the problem. You know, why are we looking at such a large gap? Is there a reason that you're thinking that? Or do you, you know, to me, if we're looking at 2 inches, 3 inches, you can still see through it. There's not animals that are going to get through it. And, you know, it's one of those that, do we put that restriction on there and limit it?
If I could reply to Mr.
Campbell.
I picked the 12 inches because that was in former cases that every time there was a front yard fence variance where the dimensions stated what the precedent seemed to be from the way the township board handled it was a 12-inch gap. I think the reason behind that is, of course, to make sure that you have visibility for cars coming around that curve on Katzman.
Right.
That they're not gonna hit anybody, or they're gonna see anybody on a bike or whatever.
I really and I appreciate that. I took a lot of time driving by that house yesterday, just because of the fact that, like I told you last time you were in, when I was younger, I actually hit a car that was, there was a bunch of hedges there and like flipped over it. You know, I took a lot of time to kind of look at the angles.
You need to see this before I cut.
No, I understand, ma'am. You know, looking at the angles, it's not an acute, sharp angle. It's fairly laid open, you know. And so to me, if we give her the ability to come 3 foot outside of the sidewalk, you end up allowing the view to stay maintain and not cause a safety issue. So to me, I guess I'm asking my co-members here. Sorry, I want to say co-workers, but you know, what do we think is a relevant spacing for the pickets on, you know, issues that may come up like this in the future? You know, I don't, obviously we're going off of history, but I also want to be thoughtful in where we move with moving forward. So, Mr. Chairman, I relinquish and back to you. But you
okay, Mr. Alexander.
And just to kind of add on to that, I do appreciate the dialogue because, again, we want to make sure anything we do stays consistent. I think we would look at the space, and if it was something like 5 feet, 6 feet, that's where probably the 12 inches would be good, so that way you don't have that visibility blocking from the height as well as the width. So I think those are some good things to consider, but I think even if we do 2-3 inches, that shouldn't be much of a deal since the fence is, what you said, 3 or 4 feet high, I think it is?
Yeah, I think it says 46 inches.
46 inches.
Yes. Mrs. Moore-Porter.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do agree with that. Moving forward, because we are creating a new, I can't think of the word of it, precedence, right, of moving forward with this, and we want it to look uniformed. I don't think a 12-inch gap or separation is very appealing either as you're driving down. And so if we're looking for some type of consistency and also keeping up with the curb appeal, that the 2-3 inch gaps between that is appropriate.
So you're looking for 2-3 inch?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so 4 inch would be okay?
4 inch will be okay. No 12, right? Mm-hmm. 4 inches is about this big. It can still look consistent without looking like there's a piece missing out of each one. I think once you get over that, the look of it changes and it doesn't look appealing, right? Because not only are we doing a variance because we want to make sure there are safety features, but then two, we want to make sure that it's also appealing. We want to make sure our neighborhoods look appealing as well.
Well, safety-wise, I think 4 inches makes sense, though, because of like pool fences are probably 4 inches.
Yeah, they're about there.
Okay. Their kids can, if it's a foot, kids can get their head in there.
Okay. I'll go along with that.
You know, so if we can agree on a 4-inch spacing, we're talking about a 4-foot-high picket fence. And I think, Mr. Zook, one of the things she mentioned was about the dogs, you're right. But she also indicated she was tired of having to maintain the hedge. Mm-hmm. So I think this might be a good compromise. I'm looking for a motion from the board before we have further discussion from the audience.
Okay, I'll make a motion to grant a variance to allow the petitioner to erect a white picket fence. What are you holding up?
This is the picket fence from the park.
Kind of a blueprint.
4 inches high, 6 inches long.
Okay, all right. It's 46 inches high.
No,
what's
4 inches high.
No. You want something taller than 4 inches.
It's 4 foot high.
Four foot.
There's only a 4-foot fence.
Yep. It's a 4-foot fence.
4 foot or 3 feet at Menard.
Okay, and this is 4 inches apart?
Okay,
it's 46 inches high for the fence. Okay. That's what's in Mr. Thompson's letter, mm-hmm. that they were talking about a 46 inch high fence. Okay, now, the gap between the slats, it doesn't. I think we're talking about 4 inches. It'd be nice.
Mr. Campbell, does it count how many are in the width or how many?
The spec sheet does not indicate
right.
width of picket or width of gap.
Yeah.
So.
Well, 4 inches is typical.
Yeah.
So not to exceed 4 inches you could put.
Okay.
Yeah, now this list, just for information, the overall height is 46 inches. The installed height is 48 inches.
Okay, so you're going to make it 48.
Okay. So, motion for 48-inch high fence with 4 inches.
Picket fence,
white picket fence, with a four-inch gap between the individual slats. Mm-hmm. And this is based upon the practical difficulty of providing safety and security for animals, wandering from adjacent properties.
Support.
Okay, motion is made to support. Further discussion from the audience?
Yes.
Go ahead, Mr. Michelle.
Yes, I like the idea of coming, you know, as a new member saying you want consistency, and I think that's great, and that's the reason. The last vinyl fence that was approved by this board was less than a year ago, and it was for a 6-foot fence that went to right where the sidewalk should be, because they also eliminated the last sidewalks required between Cass and the bike trail at George Park. So consistency would be, you really have to realize the property is landlocked per that decision. It's on tape. The township attorney has ruled it as of today. And so consistency would say you'd sure want to approve this. Thank you.
Anyone else in the audience?
So did we still keep the 36 inches from the sidewalk, or how it goes?
This is 36 inches right now.
That's what she's proposing.
Well, yes.
This is 36.
Yes. Is there anybody on the remote that wants to speak to this issue? Are there any emails?
No, sir. None of the above.
Okay. Mr. Campbell, roll call.
Mr. Campbell, yes. Mr. Alexander?
Vote yes.
Mrs. Amore-Porter?
Yes.
Mr. Zook?
No.
Mr. Merrill?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Motion passes 5-1.
Okay. Thank you. You're all set.
The only thing I don't have is my permit.
Well, you have to go to the building.
Go to the building department tomorrow.
Okay, I paid $75 already. Do I have to pay another $75 or $50?
You'd have to check with the building department, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Sitman.
Next item on the agenda is 5.57 acres of land fronting the east line of Garfield Road, south of Metropolitan Parkway. The address is 36800 Garfield Road in the Holiday Shopping Center, parcel number 1611-29105001.
Thank you.
Request for variance to add a 44 by 8 foot 6 high cooler box with storage area on property for Randazzo's Fresh Market. Mr. Campbell?
There were 151 letters sent to owners and occupants within 300 feet. 34 were returned as undeliverable. We received no written replies or emails up to today.
Thank you. Is petitioner here?
I am.
Say your name and address for the record, please.
Phil Belomo. You want the address of the building I'm talking about, or my actual address?
Your business address.
33743 Grosbeck Highway, Fraser.
Okay. Thank you. Go ahead. State your reason for the appeal.
Good evening. Thank you for allowing this. We are just trying to expand right now. We are cut for space in our back room, and there's no room for us to really move around. And with the business growing the way it is, and with all this COVID stuff going on and people wanting more space, we're having a lot of trouble spacing out our employees and just the space alone. So we're asking to put a box up to help spread us out a little bit in between our loading dock and the building itself. So we're really still within outside of our space. We're not going in any alleyways. We're not doing anything like that. We don't have any equipment going on top of the cooler. It's all in the storage space. It's all going on top of the actual building. So all that stuff would meet code and be far enough away. And so the only thing we're really asking is to utilize our space to put up a box.
So it's going between the building and the
loading
ramp,
dock.
Loading yep. dock ramp.
Mm-hmm.
And it will be lower than the height of the building?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And there's a back alley there if everybody's seen it.
Mm-hmm.
Anything else?
I don't think so, not unless you guys have any questions or anything.
Okay. Is there anyone in the audience that wants to speak on this issue?
Sam Bushell, 18546 Whalen. Basically, I'm hearing that no emails came in on this. Actually, I had sent this email earlier to you guys, to the official address, and it was on all four cases tonight. I don't know if I would hope you each got it, because it would obviously explain what I was saying. And I also sent a copy, there again, to each of you, through this, of Mr. Dolan's letter. And this is another case where, you know, and there again, this is, I shop this store all the time. They keep everything super clean. But the fact of the matter is they are landlocked per our township attorney and per this board. This board voted that to be a practical hardship. And so did, you know, the attorney has stated this is a practical hardship. They are landlocked. Every property in Clinton Township is landlocked per the township attorney and per this board. And so I think this has got to be approved. It certainly isn't nearly as invasive as putting a 6-foot tall privacy fence right up to the front yard setback, all the way to the front of the yard. Forget about 3 feet back from the sidewalk. It's not like having a dumpster next to a house. It's not like having a bar patio next to the, literally at zero. This board granted zero clearance to that. And I don't know, I don't see how you could turn down any of these cases tonight, and that's what my email said. I would hope you each get a copy of my email and also a copy of Mr. Dolan's letter. Not my stuff, his. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for your comments, but I would like to indicate that we're not adhering to that letter, whatever it is, and I haven't seen it. Basically, the zoning board comes under state statute, and each case is handled on its own. I don't have a problem with you stating that, and I don't have a problem with the petitioner tonight, but there's not a carte blanche that I know of from our attorney that says that everything has to be approved. But thank you for your comments. Is there anyone else in the audience? Is there anybody remote that wants to speak on this issue? Any emails?
No, sir.
Did you receive Mr. Bushell's email?
Yes, and I gave it to the secretary.
Okay. Mr. Campbell, do you want to read the email?
Okay. This is dealing with the one of, I don't have it in front of me. Hold on. Sort of put it aside because I had it in my file stuff at home. And the assumption I made was that if Mr. Bushell showed up, he would read it himself.
Can't do that.
Go ahead. You have two emails?
There's two emails. I'll read the one from Mr. Dolan because I'm not saying it's carte blanche that yous are tied to it. What I'm stating is, and there again, I will read his letter that I each, you know, and there again, this is the second letter that came in. I'm sure you can, it's addressed to you guys, so. But it's the fact that once a hardship like this has been granted, especially one that's so out of the, you know, outrageous.
Are you gonna read the letter though?
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Mr. Bushell. Your FOIA is requesting information, not a document, so it is denied. You can appeal to the supervisor or file a citation to the Macomb County Circuit Court from this denial. Nonetheless, here is a response again. The building department, and this part of it has to do with the fact that permits were issued in this case ahead of time. The building department, based on an enabling authority through the state construction code, adopted by the township, issued a building permit. During the foundation inspection, an encroachment was noted on setback. Following that, an application for a variance was submitted and a variance granted, which is not an uncommon process in Clinton Township or other communities. The need for variance across arose after the permit was issued. No one appealed the grant of the variance at that time. On the issued variance, the ZBA utilized the correct standard, practical difficulty, as an area rather than use the variance was thought. The property is landlocked in the sense that vehicular traffic no longer can use Hillcrest, which is blocked off at one end, and that at one time went to Grosbeck, leaving only Grosbeck ingress and egress. Conditions arose after that, after the property was platted and improved, that affected it. That were not caused by the owner as a result of the Hillcrest access closing. Whether using the term landlocked or access points restricted to describe what occurred, the facts remain. Persons aggrieved with standing could have appealed the grant of a variance in a timely done to the circuit court. None did. The other email that I sent was...
Wait, Mr. Rochelle, let me just try to explain that. When Myers was built, they closed off Hillcrest at the request of the residents on Hillcrest.
Correct.
Because of lighting and traffic problems.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the attorney's referring to one case, not a blanket.
No, he was pointing out that it's just a
difference of opinion.
You'll just have to read it, because Hillcrest, even at that point, you can't get from the subdivision of Hillcrest past this property, but you can turn off a Grosbeck and get into their parking lot off of Hillcrest. Hillcrest is still open from Grosbeck to the residential property, and there again, so this that doesn't apply. They have access on two roads.
Okay.
The properties in the north and south were both for sale.
We just have a difference of opinion.
Okay, but that's the landlocked. But that's where the township attorney said this is landlocked. And there again, there's the other email. It'll be easier for me to read because I put it larger type because it was my email. That email was from the attorney. In each of tonight's cases listed below, the properties are more landlocked, which is the practical difficulty addressed in Jay Dolan's township attorney's email of today, sent by me to the ZBA this AM. Then 26 South Grosbeck, M97, that the ZBA granted many variances, including a bar, restaurant, outside patio with zero setback from the adjacent residential property. The front, side, and backyards all had expanded uses, including a dumpster in the side yard next to the front yards of the residential homes. A vinyl fence was substituted for the required masonry wall to protect the adjacent residential district. The reduced parking of the ZBA granted had much of it on the right-of-way of Grosbeck that MDOT has demanded be removed. With this being a residential property, this all was on a residential property. So we're talking, we're not talking, it's a non-conforming use. With this being a residential property, you were granting the expansion of the long-abandoned non-conforming use on each of tonight's cases cannot be denied. If you choose to deny any of these cases tonight, they could sue the citizens of Clinton Township that you have a paid fiduciary position with. They would need to find out how the fix was in for 26 South Grosbeck. You must approve all of these landlocked properties, the requested variance. Thank you very much, Samuel F. Bushell. And that was sent early today, so you should have a copy.
Thank you. Is there anyone else in the audience about this item? Is there anyone on the internet that wants to speak on this item? Is there any emails?
No, sir.
Okay. Is there any board member that has a question on this? Mr. Campbell?
Yeah, question to the petitioner. Please confirm that this cooler, it goes between the truck well and the building.
That's what we already said. That, yep.
Okay.
Yep.
I just wanted to double check.
Yeah, yep. It's...
Now, will the sound of the refrigeration, how far away will that be heard?
We're going to put it 15 feet onto the roof of the existing building. So it'll be, that's where the existing rooftops were set by the township, that we couldn't have any equipment within that, from that rooftop to the adjacent building. So our pipes will go into the building, up onto the roof, 15 feet onto the existing building. So we'll stay within sight of that. So no equipment on top, and then the cooler's insulated, so you're not going to hear any noise from outside of that cooler.
I mean, okay, good. Thank
six
you.
6 inches of cooler. So.
In fact, there won't be any traffic on the outside because they're going to. I stopped there today, and the gentleman told me they're going to put a door through the block wall, exterior wall, so they enter it from a hallway that's behind there. It's actually a good idea if they have a very busy store there, and they need extra room to store things safely. So, anyone else? Some more?
I was just going to agree with you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I was just going to agree with you. The way it's going to be situated is going to, it's not going to interfere with any of the shopping or where people are parked. I go there all the time. I live right over there. And even where the parking spaces are on the side, no one hardly, except for employees, park on the side. So it won't be accessed by customers. So it wouldn't be a...
Yeah, and it's a one-way alley, so it's not like you got a bunch of traffic through there, so...
All right. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The only thing that I would want to be sure is, when I was back there yesterday, I noticed that there's the guardrail to prevent anybody walking or slipping into the truck well. Just want to make sure that that's planning on being kept in place, or, you know, if there's any extra room in there, just... again, safety's got to be a top priority. So
no problem. Yeah, that we're going to be with inside that rail, so the rail won't move, because the rail, that the cooler is not as long as the dock, so the dock will obviously extend further. So, like you said, we have to leave it for safety reasons. So we just made the cooler right to the rail and called it a day.
Perfect. Now, just one other thing. How are you guys planning on loading it in there? Any, have you guys thought that through? Not that that doesn't have any bearing on this determination.
Yeah, but it's all going to go through that hallway.
I want to make sure people think about, because that's not always something people do.
Yeah, it's all, it's just going to go through that hallway. So where they normally load it.
Merrill, the way they explained to me, it's for prepared food and things that they're storing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because they're crowding in the other coolers, and there are so many people getting in and out with prepared stuff that it's hard for them to keep it.
Yeah, that makes 100% sense.
So it's not going to, you're not going to see anything from outside.
Perfect. Thank you.
No problem. Thank you.
Anyone else on the board? I'll entertain a motion this time.
I'll make a motion to grant the variance as requested, based upon the practical difficulty. There is no other possible location on that property to locate this particular cooler.
Support.
Okay, the motion support. Further discussion, the audience? Anyone? Anyone on the internet?
Nope. Hold it.
Any emails?
No, sir.
Okay. So if there's no other discussion, Mr. Campbell, roll call.
Mr. Campbell, yes. Mr. Zook?
Yes.
Mr. Merrill?
Yes.
Mr. Perrell?
Yes.
Mr. Alexander?
Vote yes.
Mrs. Amor Porter?
Yes.
Motion passes it unanimously.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
Your time.
Next item on the agenda is 0.51 acres of land with cell tower. Section 3 from the south line of Hall Road, east of Heydenreich Road, addresses 21420 Hall Road, parcel 16110320027. Request approval to add a second wall sign for standard tagline where one is permitted. Request for approval for electronic message board of 45.27 square feet. Mr. Campbell?
There were... Twenty-four letters sent to owners and occupants within 300 feet. Five were returned as undeliverable. Up until now, we've received no written replies specifically for this item.
Thank you. Is the petitioner here? Is the petitioner on the internet?
He is.
Could you open your mic?
Yes, Scott Smith, Scott Consulting.
Go ahead.
700 County Road L, Waseon, Ohio, 43567.
Could you go ahead with your request?
Okay. Basically, as it was stated, we do have a tagline on the building, the range retail concealed carry class designation CPL, in addition to the name above the entryway of the building. That tagline has been used, it was integrated early in the foundation of the business to help people differentiate. They are a large retail operation, range services, and a good share of that building is actually classrooms for not just a concealed carry, but also ongoing, just safety and handling and just various types of firearms that someone might be interested in. But it's a idea that they do have constant training going on, excuse me, after you've purchased a firearm. The building itself has a frontage that would allow, it has enough frontage to allow the 261 square foot of total wall signage, but the code having that 200 square foot maximum. This proposed signs are under the 200, but it is, we do have it, that would be as a single sign. There isn't a really practical way on the building with the name to have that tagline underneath where the awning is over the doorway and have it be legible. So the idea is that they use it most of all locations where they the tagline fits the building, they have it on one of the alternate wing walls. And they do consider that a very important part of what they do. It is included in the pole sign also. In the pole sign, they are allowed 100 square foot, so the sign and the size and the setback and clearance to grade, et cetera, are all in compliance with the code. The issue comes in with the message center. One item in your calculation of area process for pole signs or signage in general, it includes the framing in the area calculation. One thing with a watch fire unit that we have proposed is this, the brand that they've been using at their locations. That unit has an additional framing than a number of units. So where it said a 45 square foot, 45.27, the actual message display area on that is only 40 square feet. So it's just something I wanted to point out, that different models use a different framing and LED display area configuration. So this one was sized based on that 4x10 unit that is available and that has the additional framing. And so that was all incorporated to stay within that 100 square feet. But when I look at 20 square foot of a message center on that pylon at that wide setback of Hall Road, I think it's probably about 200 feet to the westbound side of Hall Road anyway. But to have any a decent message in a hold position or a decent image, it's usually better to have a more vertical message center than an elongated. And really the amount of copy you could get into only 20 square foot, if we did come up with a configuration that gave you more height, the limited length of it would just make it, virtually the copy size would have to be so small to make something like that work. They do feel it's very important. They're a newcomer. The nearest site is in Wixom, Michigan. This is only their second location in Michigan, and hopefully to have more. But it is a relative newcomer to this geographic area. And so branding and synergy with any other advertising they're going to be doing, the signage is very important. They do have feature nights where they will have women's only or women's shoots where they promote either whether it's any kind of women parties or anything like that, but primarily just a time that they give discounted range time to different people groups, just kind of depending on what their special features are. So they do want to be able to advertise that in a legible copy means that does look attractive and professional in front. So I don't, I think for the most part, I don't see any kind of a traffic safety in issue or anything of a sign. I mean, you do regulate how they operate. The sign would dim with the photo cell at night, et cetera, like as your code does indicate. So, and probably the biggest reasoning for that setback or for that size of display they're requesting is the circumstances on Hall Road, just with the width of appealing to those two lanes of traffic.
Okay. Okay, well, if you got it all covered, then we'll, is there anyone in the audience that has any questions or comments? Is there anybody on the internet?
No, sir.
Any emails?
No, sir.
Okay. What's the board, any questions from the board, Mr. Campbell?
Yeah, I think the approval of two wall signs, given that the total is less than what he'd be authorized for one, that's something we've routinely approved for most businesses. The square footage of the electronic message center, while it seems large, of course, as he pointed out, Hall Road is quite wide. And to me, the sort of the biggest factor is this place is right next to Parkway, Chrysler, or whatever they're called nowadays, Chrysler Plymouth. I know they're not Chrysler Plymouth.
Got a lot of names.
Whatever they are. They have approval for a electronic message sign that's 44.7 square feet. So I think the fair thing to do is to approve what he's requested.
That's a first. Okay. Thank you. No argument from Mr. Campbell. Anyone else? If there's not, I'll entertain a motion.
I'll make a motion to grant the variance for number one, two wall signs instead of one, with the condition that the total square footage is less than what would be authorized for one wall sign. And number two, to grant approval for the electronic message center at 45.27 square feet, based upon the undue hardship that the Hall Road is a very wide road at high speeds, and this is necessary for public safety in order to see the signs.
Is there support?
And I'll support.
Okay, supported. Mr. Merrill. Further Merrill. Discussion, anyone in the audience?
Mr. Merrill.
Okay, anyone on the internet? Any emails?
No, sir.
Okay, any other discussion by the board? Roll call. Okay, roll call vote.
Mr. Campbell, yes. Mr. Merrill?
Yes.
Mr. Zook?
Yes.
Mr. Alexander?
Vote yes.
Mrs. Amor Porter?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay, you're all set.
All right, thank you very much for your time, folks.
Thank you.
Have a safe evening.
Next item on the agenda is 38802 Sheldon, 0.266 acres, lot 102, Cranberry Estate Subdivision, addressed as 38802 Sheldon, parcel 161119102041, request for variance to construct a 12-foot by 16-foot shed, 6 foot from the sidewalk. Mr. Campbell?
There were 50 letters sent to owners and occupants within 300 feet. None were returned as undeliverable. We did receive one email from a neighbor across the street that I think has been passed on to all the members of the board, so I see no reason to read it into the record.
Okay. Would the petitioner give us your name and address, please, for the record?
Yes, sir. Joe Simpson. My address is 38802 Sheldon.
Go ahead and state your request.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. So I'm requesting a variance from the 10-foot setback from the side yard. I've done a lot of improvements in the yard since I've moved in 2009, put a pool in, put a large patio in. The intent was originally to put the shed behind the pool on the other side of the yard. Unfortunately, I have a 12-foot utility easement on the rear property line. So because of that, it would have been too close to the pool. It would have been crammed in. So we decided to put it on the other side of the yard. When we put the building permit in, I was notified that because I'm on a corner lot, I have to be not 3 feet from the side lot. I have to be 10 foot from the side lot. I've supplied pictures to the board. I'm assuming that everybody has the package there. So a couple of the things that I staked out in the pictures, the pink line that I've drawn there is the measured from the sidewalk 10 foot required setback. The blue line, the blue ribbon, that I laid out is what I'm asking, which is 6 feet. So it's a few more feet towards the fence. It's not quite on top of the sidewalk, but it's going to give us quite a bit more between the shed and the patio.
Okay.
So I'm requesting the variance from the ordinance to be from a 10-foot side setback to a 6-foot. It's also not obstructing the view. You can see there's a couple bushes there in my neighbor's backyard that are actually closer to the sidewalk. That would be more obstructive. Their driveway is on the other side of their, towards the front of their yard. So there's no obstructions from the building placed in that location.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone in the audience?
Once again, he's obviously landlocked, and that would be his practical difficulty. And this 6 feet, there again, set back from the sidewalk compared to a zero for a dumpster to a neighbor's front yard is a little bit different, and zero to the sidewalk. Zero for a bar patio operating until 2:30 in the morning at the fence line to the house next door. I think if this gets turned down, if I was the petitioner, if I got turned down, I would literally, he could ask me tonight for a copy of the attorney's letter, and I would FOIA a copy of the meeting where all this other stuff was approved, because, you know, there again, consistency. You can't treat people differently. He's definitely landlocked, more landlocked than the property that got all these other variances as landlocked. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else in the audience? Anyone on the internet? Any emails?
None, sir.
Okay. What's the board? Any board has any questions of the petitioner, Mr. Campbell?
Yeah, first of all, I have to comment, being landlocked per se is not a criteria to grant a variance. Never has been. It's maybe one factor to consider. But instead of landlocked, I would use the term as to whether there is room to expand in the direction for the proposal that's being made. One question, the document we have that was written up by the planning department says it's going to be 5 feet from the street side lot. You're saying 6.
So my original request was 5 feet from the fence line. I didn't realize that the ordinance required it from the sidewalk. And so the sidewalk to the fence measurement is 1 foot.
Okay.
So then that's a total of 6 feet. So my original request was 5 feet from the fence line.
And if I may?
Yes.
Thank you. And that is the difference. I just wanted to confirm, and so this gentleman understood as well. Property lines start 1 foot inside the sidewalk. And so when a setback is measured, it's measured at a property line. It's not measured at a fence or a sidewalk.
Oh.
And so that's why my report indicated 5 feet, because we have to reference it from the property line and not the sidewalk. So the 6 foot was from the sidewalk, but in actuality, if they're going to grant a variance, it has to be from the property line, and that's why it says 5 feet. It will still be the same location that you are requesting. I just had to refer it in my report based on property line. That's all.
I was unaware of that. Thank you for clarifying.
You're welcome, sir.
Thank you. Anyone else?
I did have a question.
Mrs. Porter?
Is there a particular reason why it's 10 feet from the property line?
Mr. Thompson?
I cannot answer that question. It was a decision that was made when whatever ordinance was enacted a long time ago. It's likely you'll find that the ordinances like that are drawn from other ordinances in similar communities. Typically, when ordinances are created, they're created by consulting firms who do similar work for other communities. So I think you'll find it's consistent with some communities and not consistent with others. It was just the number that was picked when that accessory ordinance was enacted.
Okay.
Did that answer your question?
Mm-hmm, it did. Thank you.
Yeah, there's currently going on an ordinance update.
Okay.
So there's, I believe a number of us are on that, along with planners and Mr. Thompson, and I think you hired a group to do that.
Yes, we use a consulting firm.
At any ordinance updates, too, that would maybe come to more reasonable decisions on some of these things.
Okay.
And we've done some in the past. We've sent it to the township board to request some things be changed and updated, and they've done a lot of them. And sometimes they do it on their own. So it is that It is a thing that's changed all the time, so maybe this is one that they'll have to look at. Anyone else on the board? Mr. Campbell?
Yeah, I was just going to make the comment that I think the common sense interpretation as to why we have this different setback on a street side is basically to ensure that there's visibility for any vehicle going down that street. And as if, you know, if it were just adjacent to another lot, it would be a different story because you're not going to have people trying to make turns or turn left or turn right. And looking at this particular property, where he wants to put the shed, in my opinion, he's back far enough from the intersection of Sheldon and whatever that other street is, that
Pembroke.
Okay. Yeah. That there's no concern. I don't think, in my opinion, there isn't any concern that the shed would interfere in any way with the traffic making a turn at that intersection.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Merrill.
Just real quick for the petitioner. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Have you talked to your neighbors behind you at all? I mean, I know that the township sends out letters notifying them of the meeting, but I was just curious as to if you've talked to them and what their opinion or thoughts were.
Oh, yeah. He came out when I was staking it out, and he goes, okay, now what are you doing, Joe? And I said, well, we want to put the shed over here. Obviously, it's going to be too encroached to the pool. Going to put it over here. Want it far enough away that it's not going to be obstructing his view of the neighborhood, and far enough away that we can also plant some vegetation in between there, do some flowers in between the shed. And I think it's a pretty attractive looking shed too. It's
I not just so a
so does my wife. She wants to make it the she shed, where that's where she's gonna be doing
more. Just as long as it doesn't burn down.
Exactly. Right? And so he had no objection. And the one neighbor, I'm not sure if she wrote in an email, it doesn't sound like she did, but she said that she was gonna write and she had no objection either. So
thank you.
Mm-hmm. Now the email was quite positive.
Oh, good to hear.
Okay, well, what's the board's pleasure?
I make a motion to grant the variance as requested based upon the practical difficulty of the existence of a corner lot and a rear yard easement for utilities. Makes it difficult to find an adequate location for a shed to store homeowners' property and pool equipment and everything else.
For the record, that's 5 foot from the lot line.
Yes, correct. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I'll support that.
Correct. That's correct, yes, sir.
Supported?
Yes.
Okay. Further discussion, anyone in the audience? Anyone on the internet?
None.
Any other emails?
No, sir.
No. Okay. Mr. Campbell, roll call.
Mr. Campbell, yes. Mr. Alexander?
Votes yes.
Mrs. Moore-Porter?
Yes.
Mr. Zook?
Yes.
Mr. Merrill?
Yes.
Mr. Farrell?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you, Chairman, members.
Thank you.
That was the last of the action items. Report of the meeting of July 21st.
Public comments?
Yeah, report of the meetings first.
No, public comments is first.
Oh, yeah.
I'm reading the agenda. We have two different agendas, I guess. Huh?
Yeah. The ones I've got say public comments first.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, that's not the one I have.
Huh. Yeah, I see what you did. Okay, what do you want to do, the meeting?
Yes.
Okay. I have no comments on last month's meeting minutes. I'd move to approve as written.
And supported.
Any discussion?
Merrill.
All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Motion carries. Okay, we're going to go into public comments. Comments will be limited to 3 minutes. Comments by persons must be confined to Zoning Board of Appeals business, meaning topics over which the Zoning Board has authority and which involve Zoning Board of Appeals matters. Should the board decide that in response to a specific question raised by the persons at the public comment section is needed, the board shall refer the question to the Planning and Community Development Department director or designee for review. Go ahead, Mr. Bichette.
Yes, this my favorite subject, 26 South Grosbeck, which I hope all of you watched the meeting where it was approved. But the approval was also granted fewer parking spots than required, but several of them are actually in the road right away. Michigan Department of Transportation, when I sent them a copy of site plan that was going to be approved and what you've approved for them, you know, this reduced site plan, reduced parking. They have demanded that be removed. It's right where the sidewalk would go. But anyways, I would assume, you know, I just wanted to make sure that, you know, this board, who, you know, you appealed the lower parking. The place has got a temporary certificate of occupancy without the required, even the reduced parking that you've granted. I wanted to make sure that, you know, you would let the township planner know that he would follow up on that, because their temporary CO is to expire in September, real quick, September 1st. And I think that this, you know, the ZBA would want to know that, okay, you gave this people everything possible, and they just didn't do it. They've got, you know, they've got the dumpster. Instead of putting it in the dumpster enclosure, it's next to the building, right next to where the food goes in and out, and the kitchen. And there's nothing protecting the neighbors. The dumpster now is right next to the vinyl fence in their front yards. I don't think any of us want that. And I also feel that this ZBA may want to, in as much as you didn't get a copy of the attorney's email today, I think that this board would really want to have the township have the attorney update you on the fact that you do have to have consistency, that you can't turn around and grant one property these wild variances and then the next. I've seen homeowners in here begging. You can watch some of the old meetings, and they get turned down right and left for anything. And I just think that this board may want to have the township maybe school you with the attorney. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else in the audience? Anyone on the internet that has any comments?
Nobody there.
And no email?
No, sir.
Okay. We'll go to the meeting schedule.
I actually don't have anything with me at this point. If there is something that is coming up for the next one, I'm sure there will be, I'll email you folks, let you know what it is.
Okay, then, and then we're all set otherwise?
Yep.
Need a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Support.
You want to do a roll call?
No.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you. I appreciate everybody's help tonight.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.